Hey guys, so this is me Abhilasha, your favorite VRC mentor, and I'm back again on Topper Speak. This of course is our session where we discuss with the toppers, with the CAT toppers about their preparation, about what they've done and about their success journey. Now today of course I've got someone with me who I first met some 5 or 6 years ago. He used to be my student in Kolkata and he was a very young boy then. Then suddenly cut to this year and I meet him on, I get a message from him on Facebook and he's like, hey ma'am, I've cracked the IFT, hey ma'am, I've cracked MDI. And I'm like, whoa man, that's amazing. And so here is Atul with some very interesting discussion about his CAT journey. But before I begin, let me just do my quick round of announcements for all of you and then we'll get started, and there's lots to come and we'll have a long, long chat with Atul. Alright, so here is my referral code is AbhiCAT. Remember to unlock all the Unacademy courses and subscribe. Also guys, our iconic batches are live, so you can get the advantage of our one-to-one mentorship program. Just use AbhiCAT Live to unlock and also to subscribe and get a 10% off. Here's our CAT 2020 result. My very own Piyush Pratik with a 99.25% and just makes me very proud. New batches for CAT 22, guys, Aspire and Unlock. You've got starting 10th of July and 17th of July. Some new batches for CAT 21. 7 July, 10 July and 14 July, Excellence Revisor and CAT Specialist 1.0. All of these batches can be subscribed by using AbhiCAT Live and you can get a 10% off also. Our biggest weekly scholarship test, Combat, happens every Sunday at noon. So what you have to do is just use my referral code to enroll, or you can scan this QR code also. Also guys, our Unacademy Maestro Scholarship worth 1.5 crores is live now, so you can take advantage if you are a final year engineering student. Just log on to Unacademy, use AbhiCAT Live to enroll and just get started with the scholarship. Every day there is one iPad to be won. Whoa! Ask a Doubt is live guys on our Unacademy Plus Learners app. Just go to the app, download it and then you can just ask all your doubts there. Okay, so that's a little bit about. I am starting a brand new course today, that is the 12th of July, that's on para-based reasoning. So do make sure you're coming in 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. every day, Monday to Thursday. Alright guys, that's a little bit about me and my courses, and of course we will stop now, and of course I'll welcome my dear student Atul, and let's talk to him. Hi Atul, welcome.
Hi ma'am, happy to be here. Thanks for inviting me for this session.
I am so excited, yaar. I can't tell you honestly, because I'll tell you something guys, you know, when I first met Atul, I used to teach in Kolkata. I used to travel from Lucknow to Kolkata and every 15 days I think I was there, and we used to take classes. I used to teach VRC and critical reasoning to these guys, and here was this very sweet, pyara sa, adorable sa bacha. जो हर क्लास में आता था, बहुत जेंटल स्वीट, एंड आई यूज टू रियली यू नो लुक फॉरवर्ड टू हिम. तो बाद में 3-4-5 साल बाद जब मेरे को मैसेज आता है अतुल झुनझुनवाला एंड सेज हाय मैम, आई एम लाइक अरे यार ये क्यूट सा बच्चा कहाँ से आ गया फिर से. तो अतुल टेल मी अ लिटिल बिट अबाउट योर जर्नी फ्रॉम क्लैट टू कैट. व्हाट हैपेंड इन बिटवीन दीज 5 ईयर्स, हाउ डिड यू कम टू कैट?
सो I was a commerce student in my plus two, like you know. So, like after you have taken commerce, you have several career options. So, मैं वही explore कर रहा था, and I happened to stumble upon law as a career option. And my sister had also taken CLAT, so I thought maybe you know I should take CLAT and see if I get into one of the top law schools. But you know, even after 2 years of preparation, I could not get a very good CLAT rank, and I could not crack one of the top NDUs. So that's when I decided on joining St. Xavier's College, because my 12th score was it was decent enough to get me an admitted to St. Xavier's College. So I joined St. Xavier's College and I was pursuing BCom there. Then I started with the CFA course in my first year, and in those 3 years I completed CFA and I completed BCom, and I happened to get a placement out of my college placement cell in a company called Futures First, where I was working as a derivatives trader. So 1.5-2 years later, I realized that maybe, you know, it's the time for me to further upskill myself to get greater challenges and better opportunities in the industry. And that's when I started looking for further education, a master's. And like every other aspirant, I happened to stumble upon CAT for MBA. And I think it was back in March 2020 when I decided that I'll be taking CAT 2020 very seriously and give it my best. And the lockdown, obviously, it helped because we were working from home and I was getting, you know, more number of hours to dedicate towards CAT preparation. So that's how CAT happened for me. And I happened to score a decent enough percentile to get calls from colleges like IIM Lucknow and MBI and IFT. So, and I managed to convert colleges like MBI, IFT and NMIM. So yeah, that's my journey in very, very brief.
Wonderful. So what was your CAT percentile like? Just tell us a little bit about it. I get very excited at all of that. So tell us what was your CAT percentile and break it up into the three sections also.
So my CAT percentile was 97.55 and I had a 98.8 in VRC and my LRDI was 89.6. I do not remember the exact percentile and quant was 96 points something. And I did not score really well in ZAT because ZAT's quant was a little tricky and it was a little tricky for me, so I could not clear the ZAT quants cutoff. In IFT, I scored 95% and whereas in NMAT, I had a score of 260K. So these were the four exams that I took and those are my scores.
Okay, so you just wrote four exams. You didn't think about writing any of the other exams. What was the plan like? Were you focused on, hey, these are the colleges I am going to go to? Or was it that I'll go to any college that will just take me?
No, actually, while preparing for CAT, I had this in mind that I want to go just to the top 10 colleges. Because I was doing decent in my job. And in order to switch and, take a break for 2 years for studies, I wanted it to be from one of the best colleges. Otherwise, I was happy enough in my job to be. So that's how I decided that I was willing to take just three exams, CAT, ZAT and IFT, because those are the gateway to the top 10 institutes. But later on, when the fourth window for NMAT opened, and by that time I had already gotten my CAT and ZAT results, which were not really great. So that's when I decided that maybe I should take NMAT as well, so that worst comes worst, I at least have a backup college in my hand. Because with my CAT percentile, I wasn't really expecting it to be very easy to convert the colleges that I had a call from.
Okay, all right. Okay, so what about your CAT preparation? What all did you do while you were preparing for CAT? Tell us a little bit about that. You said that you were working simultaneously. And yeah. My question is also, it's a little integrated question. My question is that what does a derivatives trader do, just for for our students? Just tell us that. And then tell us what was the timeline, like how much time you gave to your work, how much time you had, you know, for your preparation, and tell us a little bit about all of that.
So starting with the first question that you asked, what does a derivative trader do? So I was an interest rates derivative trader in the Brazilian market. So my job was to understand the interest rate curves in the Brazilian economy and take positions according to that. So basically I study the economy, and if I understand that the long-term interest rates are going to go up, whereas the short-term interest rates might fall, so I'll build a position in that manner where I benefit out of my study, where I benefit out of my predictions. So there were several tools to do that. We traded on currency, we traded on different maturities or interest rates, and that's how the trading was done. Now coming to the second part of your question, that is how much time did I dedicate to my work and studies. So my job shift was according to the timing of the Brazilian markets. So I was supposed to report to work at 5 p.m. and my job went on till 3 a.m. So that was 10 hours of work, which required me to stay up late in the night. So that's how my cycle was in general. So like I said earlier, I first started my preparation when the first phase of lockdown happened. So because I had time during the morning, I started with classes from, let's say, 12 to 4. That was before my office time. So that's how I went about in the first 1.5 months. And I got a grip about what the, you know, what the syllabus is and who the teachers are on an academy and what is their teaching style. So you, if you are joining classes, you need some time to get accustomed to what the teacher is teaching, what the teacher's teaching style is. And you need some time to get used to the atmosphere in an online class. So I think I took 1 month for that, and I was studying on an average 3 to 4 hours. I was just attending classes. And then later on, when I was accustomed to everything, I built a study plan for myself where I was working from 5 to 3 and generally studying from 4 to 8 in the morning. So that's when I started with a little bit of self-studies as well. I started solving some RCs, I started solving some LRDI sets and a few questions from quants here and there. But I tried to maintain the 4-hour study block right till September. Post which I resigned from my job. I worked till 5th of October, and in the last 50 days, I think I was studying on an average 5 to 6 hours a day. I was writing a lot of mocks, and obviously the mocks, the practice that you get from the mocks, it helps a lot during the exam. So that's how I planned it, that I would try to cover whole of my syllabus, studying 4 hours a day for the first few months, and then write as many mocks as I can during the last phase. So when I started writing the mocks during August, September, I wasn't getting really good marks. So that's when I decided that maybe it's time to give more time to the preparation. And that's when I decided to resign. And after 5th of October, I started giving more time into that preparation. And that's how I managed to score a decent percentage.
Okay, wonderful. So, you mentioned that you had a study plan, right?
Yeah.
So your study plan said that, hey, study for 4 hours, but how were you studying? Like, people ask me this question, that ma'am, kaise padhe, kitne ghante padhe, kya padhe, like maths ka padhna hai, DI kitna padhna hai, VRC kitna padhna hai. So what was your breakup of your study plan? Tell us a little bit about that.
So initially, I had decided ki English and LRDI are the subjects that I wanted to focus on, because I had this idea in mind that maths is something which requires constant practice, and maybe if I do it during the initial months and I take a break, so I'll forget it later on. So I started off very aggressively with English and VRC and LRDI, because that trains your mind in a manner which you cannot forget. So basically, once you know how to solve the RCs, once you know how to think in the LR sets, you cannot forget that later on. So like I mentioned, I started in the month of March, late in March. So March, April, May, I was very, very focused on VRC and LRDI. And that helped me to a large extent, because that set my mind thinking in the right direction. Like whenever I used to solve an RC set, even in the month of June or July, I did not have to study anything new. I could just practice it. Whereas for maths, when I started with quants in the month of June, I think I knew that I had to constantly be in touch, otherwise I'll forget the formulas. So I started off with this plan where I was studying for 2 hours VRC and for another 2 hours LRDI. That was for the first few months, and then later on, when I knew that I had a decent grip on these two subjects, I decided to give 2 hours of the day towards practicing of these two subjects, and I picked quants for 2-2.5 hours from the month of June, I think. So that helped me to a great extent, because I had that mindset in place to solve VRC and LRDI, and I was practicing it for 1 hour each daily, whereas I was learning new concepts every day in quants. And because I was in constant touch with quants as well, I did not really forget the formulas, or did not forget the concepts, or had the need to, you know, sit down and revise for 10 days at a stretch. So I did not have to dedicate that time to quants. So I think that systematically worked out in my field.
Okay, so are you naturally inclined towards quant, or what is your natural section?
My natural section was LRDI, but I ended up scoring the least in LRDI.
Okay.
But when I started taking mocks, and by the time I had taken 10 to 12 mocks, I realized that my natural, the section where I naturally score the most is VRC. And that showed in the actual paper as well, because I used to approach VRC with a very, very different mindset. I was not the one who would, you know, I would just read the passage. The people would read the passage and go on answering the questions. I used to treat VRC as something like a game where you have to find the answer to a question. So I used to read the questions, I used to go back to the passage, and a lot of to and fro. And people say that it takes more time, but I had made a strategy for myself where this took the least amount of time. And that will happen only after you practice a lot. So like I mentioned, after the 10th or 12th mock, I realized that VRC is the one where I have actually cracked the process of how to optimize my score in the least possible time. So yeah, but initially, during preparation, I liked LRDA the most, and I thought that was the one section where I'll score the most. But like the exam CAT is, it's pretty unpredictable, and I ended up scoring the least in LRDA.
So which slot were you in? The first, second, or the third slot?
I was in the second slot.
Oh, my slot.
Yeah.
Okay. That was a good slot. Huh?
Yeah.
The VRC section was like crazy.
Even the LRDA section, I was very shocked after. I was expecting the VRC to be difficult because slot one had difficult VRC. And yeah, VRC was difficult. But when we got to LRDI and we saw the difficulty level of LRDI, that's when I realized that this is the real difficult section. VRC might have been easy.
Yes. So CAT is always like that. It keeps changing and it's very deceptive, to be very honest. Every time they come up with something and वो कुछ ऐसा ही हो जाता है कि कुछ अलग सा ही निकल के आ जाता है. ओके, सो टेल अस अ लिटिल बिट अबाउट योर आईएफटी एग्जाम आल्सो, बिकॉज यू डिड क्रैक दैट. सो टेल अस, क्या था पेपर, तुमने क्या किया, व्हाट वाज योर स्ट्रेटजी अबाउट आईएफटी?
सो फॉर द आईएफटी एग्जाम, आई थिंक द सिलेबस रिमेंस द सेम.
कैन यू बी अ लिटिल लाउडर? आई थिंक योर,
सो इज इट बेटर नाउ?
या, स्लाइटली बेटर.
ओके, सो फॉर द आईएफटी एग्जाम, आई थिंक द सिलेबस रिमेंस द सेम. For VRC, I think for IFT VRC, we need to prepare on a few more topics like some foreign words and some idioms. So I obviously followed ma'am's classes for that. And I think the strategy for the exam is IFT is basically, it's supposed to be an exam where you have to be very, very quick. You have to attempt as many questions as you can. And the difficulty level, it's slightly lower than CAT in general. Especially when it comes to sections like VRC and LRDI. Quants is at par, but VRC and LRDI, I think I found CAT to be a notch higher than IFT. So my strategy for IFT was to just cover the extra portions that were there for the syllabus and then take as many mocks as I can, because that would get me used to writing the exam in a very, very hasty manner. So for CAT, I used to take my time and I used to focus on accuracy. Like, I knew that if I could crack 3 sets in LRDI and if I could crack 15 questions in quants, I am set. But for IFT, I knew that the questions were a little easier and I have to get as many questions correct as possible in order to maximize my marks. So that is one thing that I had in mind. So like always, my VRC section was a little better than the rest too. So since the IFT exam does not have sectional limits, I try to be focused on the VRC section and get as many marks out of that section as possible. And then whatever time I had, I tried to clear the cutoff and maximize whatever I could in the other two sections.
Okay. So you got a 95 percentile in IFT, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, wonderful. And in CAT, you got calls to IIM Lucknow.
And? I had Lucknow, Shillong, MDI. Okay. And all CAP colleges.
Okay, Lucknow, Shillong, MDI and all CAP colleges. Wonderful. So tell us a little bit about your interviews also. Let's just talk a little bit about your interviews also. So tell me, how were your interviews? And also tell us what happened in the IFT interview process. So can we just,
So for the other interviews, my first interview was IIM Lucknow. It was, I think, 12th of February, if I'm not wrong. So for IIM Lucknow, we had to fill a form and we had to write some answers like, I think it was why MBA and what are your future plans. So we had to submit that form and the interview was based on that form and my past record. So I was asked questions on my academics, and my graduation was a little on the lower side. So I am Lucknow professors, they really gave me a tough time with respect to that, because they asked me questions like, why is it so low, and will you really be able to cope up with the Lucknow curriculum, because Lucknow is supposed to be the most rigorous course when it comes to academics. So yeah, and there were other questions with regards to my career, like what have I done in trading in futures first, and what do I expect out of Lucknow after graduating, what kind of industry do I want to work in, what type of job role do I want. So that was a general interview, and they asked me some surprising questions out of 10th and 12th. Like, they asked me to recite a poem which I had studied in class 10. So that is something that I obviously did not remember. And I tried to summarize a poem for them, but they wanted the lines, I mean, they wanted line by line. So that was something that was off. And I was asked a riddle, a logical reasoning riddle, which I managed to solve. Now, next in line was CAP. That was a very short interview, I think it lasted less than 10 minutes, and they asked me some very general questions about the budget. They asked me some questions regarding commerce, like some concepts. I think they asked me how to calculate NPV, and when I said the theoretical answer, they asked me to state a real life example of how to calculate an NPV, where I managed to give them a real life example, and they were happy with the answer. And there were some other questions on extracurriculars, and it was a very short interview. And now moving next to, I think the next three interviews were Shillong, MDI and IFT. So the MDI interview was obviously, it was one of the better interviews that I had taken, because the questions, they did not necessarily, revolved around my door graduation marks. That they asked some questions with respect to my CV, and other questions with respect to my interests, and overall it was a very well-rounded interview. They tried to cover three or four aspects of my personality, not just academics. So that was one interview where I think I fared well and I managed to convert. Shillong interview was based more around the place that I have lived in. So they asked me a lot of questions regarding Kolkata and Howrah, especially because I live in Howrah. So they asked me questions like, when was the Howrah station established, and how many platforms are there, and they asked me a little bit of history of the Howrah station, and they were asking me my college's history, who was St. Xavier, and which countries did he visit, things like that. So Shillong interview was a little on the, it was more based on the regional side. They also asked me a little about Bengal politics, because Bengal elections were supposed to happen at that time. So they asked me my views on Mamata Banerjee and the BJP candidate, which candidate might be a suitable one for CM's post, things like that. And the last interview that I had was IFT. So for IFT, it was a twofold process. They tried to conduct a WAT, but it was scrapped because there were problems conducting it online. So it was WAT, extempore, and PI. So the extempore was taken along with the PI, and I think the topic of my extempore was, should ex-criminals be, it was something related to ex-criminals, like should ex-criminals be given free education or something like that. So my extempore went on for 2 minutes, and I think the extempore was pretty decent. But the interview part was a little dicey, because they asked me a lot of questions with respect to foreign affairs. They asked me questions regarding Quad and SAR and other international organizations. Since it's a foreign trade college, so they try to focus a lot on international relations of India and what is currently the scenario going on. What is the relation of India with the country X? So if you are appearing for the IFT interview, these are the few points that you must know, because they drill into that a lot. So yeah, IFP was also, it was on the decent side, and I managed to go.
So you cracked both IFT and MDI. So now The sticky question, why are you joining MDI and why are you not joining IFT?
I think MDI and IFT, deciding one amongst these two was probably one of the most difficult decisions that I have taken in my life, because if you take a look at the rankings of these two colleges, they are pretty neck to neck, and there's some magazine that rates MBA better, while there's another one that rates IIT better. And especially given my specialization, like I have a CFA background and I've worked for 2 years in trading firm, IFP should have been a natural choice for me. But I think I chose MDI just because MDI was one of the colleges that I was really hoping to get into while I started my CAT preparation, because I had really low graduation marks, like I mentioned. So the two colleges that could have given me a realistic, where I had a realistic chance, were XL and MBA. And these two were my dream colleges. So there was that personal bias. Then secondly, I had spoken to lots of people who were recent graduates of both these colleges. And after speaking to a lot of IFP current students and IFP recent passouts, I could sense that people were not very happy with the way the college has been operating during the pandemic. And they were not really happy with the way classes have been conducted and placement scenario has been going on in the last 1 year. So I think pandemic had taken a really, IFP had taken a really huge blow because of the pandemic. So seeing the second wave and expecting the third wave going forward, I thought that maybe MDI was a safer call. So that's why I decided. And like I said, it was a very, very difficult decision because it's a complete 50-50, and I should have been inclined towards IFT given my financial profile. But now that I have taken a decision, let's hope for the best.
All right, wonderful. That is so interesting. But yeah, I'll tell you what, ultimately it is you who has to decide, and it's your call. And however much we'll tell you that अरे IFT चले जाओ या यहाँ चले जाओ, वो decision तुम्हारा है, and I think you've taken a wonderful decision. MDI is a great, great college. I have a lot of friends from MDI and who are doing very well, and they're very happy with their alma mater. So I here's wishing you all the best, Atul, in MDI. May you go there and may you just rock the college and everything else. I am sure that you will do very well there. There are no doubts about that. Somebody as hardworking, as sweet, as sincere as you is surely going to do wonders wherever you go. So not just at MDI, but also wherever after MDI you will go, I'm sure you will be known for that sweet smile and for the work that you do. So let's wrap up the session. I think I have taken a lot of your time, Atul. So let's wrap it up. And your voice is not coming.
So I was saying that it was lovely having this conversation with you, and I am really overwhelmed that you still remember me and you still have those wishes about me. You still wish the best for me. So it is obviously very, very overwhelming when someone you knew 5 or 6 years back, they still have that feeling for you, that they want you to do well in life. So I'm very, very happy to have been a part of this conversation, and I'm looking forward to get in touch with you more often than we did in the past.
We will stay in touch. Next year when it's time for interviews for the next batch, I'm going to call you up and ask you to come and take some interviews and do some help for our students, because obviously if the seniors are not going to do it, who is?
So we'll definitely be looking forward to that.
So we will have lots of people who want to crack IFT, who want to crack MDI and a lot of other IIMs. I'm going to put them on to you, and maybe you can also help them join great colleges just like you have. Thank you, Atul. It has been wonderful talking to you. And all you guys out there, see, here is a shining example of someone who has done wonderfully well in his CAT preparation. And of course, I'm sure he will do wonderfully well in his future also. So here's wishing you all the best, guys. Everyone else, if you wish to stay connected with Atul or with me, all you have to do is drop a message in the message box down below and we'll stay in touch. I'm going to ask Atul to join our Telegram group also, so that everybody else can take advantage of you also. All right. Thank you, Atul. Thank you, everybody. Have a nice day.